Matthew 6:25-34. I tell you, do not worry. Do not worry about your life and what you will eat or drink, and don't worry about your body and what you will wear. Isn't there more to life than eating? Aren't there more important things for your body than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They don't plant or gather crops. They don't put away crops in storerooms. But your Father who is in heaven feeds them. Aren't you worth much more than they are? Can't you add even 1 hour to your life by worrying? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the wildflowers grow? They don't work or make clothing. But here is what I tell you. Not even Solomon in all of his glory was dressed like one of those flowers. If that is how God dresses the wild grass, won't he dress you even better? After all, the grass is here only today. Tomorrow it is thrown into the fire. Your faith is so small. So don't worry. Don't say, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? People who are ungodly run after all those things. Your Father who is in heaven knows what you need, But put God's kingdom first. Do what he wants you to do. Then all of those things will also be given to you. So don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own.
In an age of Tylenol and Advil and Excedrin, Xanax, hydrocodone, Ambien, excessive alcoholism, and other crutches for tattered nerves, does God have a word for those who feel stressed out? Does God have a word to the recent college graduate trying to find their niche in life? He or she's been blessed with certain gifts, but they just can't seem to find the right job that will compensate them for their abilities. Does God have a word for a young couple that's struggling to pay bills? They always thought that two could live as cheap as one, but they found but for only half as long. And now they're wondering how they're going to make it, not only through this month, but the next month. Does God have a word for a man who has recently been laid off of his job after 25 years of service? He's now 54 years of age, and he's got to find a new job that not only will compensate him to live the same lifestyle that he's been living, but also to give him the benefits that he's going to need as well. Does God have a word for the individual who feels like life has become monotonous? Once life was exciting, it was thrilling, it was almost like going to an amusement park. But now, as B.B. King would say, the thrill is gone. And you find yourself in a routine. And you wonder, is life ever going to be like it once was? Does God have a word for a young couple who more than anything wants to have a child, but they're not able to conceive? They've tried everything and exhausted almost all their money. Other children in this world that aren't wanted, but they can't afford to adopt a child. Does God have a word for the individual who's lost a family member or a close friend? That person was your guide. It was your compass. And now, all of a sudden, they're no longer here. There are words that you wish that you have said. There's time that you cannot make up. And you wonder, your day is always going to be dark. Will the light ever shine again, and will you feel like you used to? Does God have a word for the high school students who are doing their best to do the right thing, much to the displeasure of their friends and their peer group? Peer group has put so much pressure on them to conform to society that pressure gets tighter and tighter and tighter. And after a while, the young people start thinking, well, what good does it do to be good? I just ought to just follow the crowd and do what they're doing. Does God have a word for an individual who has a burden in their life because of sin that has taken place? Their guilt is so great, and they start thinking, if people really knew what I've done, nobody would love me, nobody would speak to me, and nobody would be my friend. I'd put a gun to my head and end it all, but I'm afraid I'd miss to the right. In a world full of anxiety, no wonder there's a small town in the South that has two major industries. They have an industry that produces fertilizer and an industry that produces aspirin. And the tonnage of aspirin per year exceeds the tonnage of fertilizer produced. Think about that for a moment. Most of us feel like we're in a juggling circus, don't we? Really. In our lives, most of us are stressed to the max. I mean, we got jobs, we got children, we got spouse, church, bills. And before you know it, the balls start going faster and faster and faster and faster. And you start wondering, when is life going to get easy? Is it always going to be that hard? Have you ever asked that question? Why does it have to be so hard? One psychologist said it this way. The problem of happiness exists in the pressing of two buttons. A button to your past and a button to your future. But you know it's not that simple. There are, though, a lot of us that are unhappy because of the things that we have done in the past. And when the past is always before you, it robs you of the joy of this day. And so many of us have got to get to a point in place in our lives where we say, I cannot change the past. I can only live in the present. But there are others who are always worried about the future. What could happen? What might happen? Worry is interest on a note before it becomes due. And most of our worry is self-induced about things that could happen, things that might happen. And we become so consumed with these things until they control us, and we find ourselves in a proverbial tizzy, as my mother used to say. Now let's look at the text this evening that Isabella read for us so eloquently just a few moments ago, and see what God's word is for anxious hearts this evening. Now, if you have a King James version, that's fine. That King James version may read this way: take no thought for your life, or take no thought for your life, or for tomorrow. Now, you might think, well, that can't be right. I have to think about my life. I have to think about tomorrow. I have a schedule that I have to keep. I have to go to work tomorrow. Children have to do homework. Children would love for us to not take any thought about tomorrow. Because in that way, all responsibility would be thrown out the window. Jesus is not saying, don't prepare for tomorrow. Even in his parables, he talked about the necessity to prepare for the future. He talked about the parable of the sower, the parable of the talents, the parable of the foolish bridesmaids that didn't prepare and have enough oil for their lamps at night. Another translation writes it this way: don't be concerned about tomorrow. And you might say, well, that's impossible, because I am concerned. I'm concerned about my child's education. I'm concerned about what we're going to do with mama and daddy when they get to a point in time where they can't take care of themselves. I am concerned about taking on more financial debt. I am concerned that we as a church are going to have to borrow money. I am concerned about what's taking place in our country. It's hard not to be concerned. Another translation writes it this way: do not be anxious. Now, Jesus never demanded the impossible. Jesus never asked us to do something that he didn't empower us or wasn't going to empower us to do. I mean, we're anxious enough to hopefully have a little bit of money laid to the side in case of an emergency. Another version reads this way. Don't worry. Don't worry about tomorrow. And you're thinking, wouldn't that be nice? Let me have a show of hands tonight. How many of you think that you suffer from a little bit of anxiety or stress? That's pretty much 100%, isn't it? You know, in the church, we ought to be a little transparent, shouldn't we? So we're all in the same boat. You know, the people that say, I don't ever worry about anything, usually don't have much responsibility. There's a great deal of pressure that goes with living life just normally. And then you start compounding life with spouse, children, job, education, all of these things, and sometimes it gets a little bothersome. It gets a little heavy. I believe what Jesus is teaching us in this story is he is encouraging us not to be distracted by life. And I think a lot of us are way distracted by life. Don't be distracted about tomorrow, because you have to live in the now at this moment. Don't be paralyzed by fear of what could happen. Fear is one of those things that can motivate you, but fear can also paralyze you and keep you from doing what God wants you to do. And so I believe what Jesus is saying is, don't get distracted over here. Keep your eyes on the prize. Now, he wasn't advocating a listless life. He wasn't advocating a reckless life. He wasn't advocating a thoughtless life or a devil-may-care attitude of life. But what he was saying was this, and this is true. Excess worry takes the joy out of living. Excess worry about what could happen takes the joy out of life. And folks, let me tell you something. There is joy in this journey. There is joy in this journey simply because of the people that you meet and how they affect your life. The other day, I had one of those epiphanies, one of those aha moments, if you will, about the people who have just touched my life. And I was just overwhelmed when I started thinking about the people that God has marched into my life. I had an opportunity to go back to Canton, Mississippi and do a funeral this past week for a lady who was on the search committee that called me to that church. She was 95 years of age. And when I got there, whenever I go back to Canton, it's almost like a family reunion for me. And I'm going to tell you what I have learned at the age of 55 that I wished I would have known at the age of 30. And I'm going to share it with you right now. And I'm going to share it with these young people. It's going to go right over their heads, but maybe when they're 55, they'll think back to this time. Sometimes the most poignant moments in some of the greatest relationships are right there in front of us, and we don't appreciate them. We don't realize those special moments when they're in front of us and special people. And I go back, Wiley, to Canton, and I think I was as happy there as I've been anywhere in my life. And those people were good to me. I probably didn't enjoy it as much as I should have. I may have been looking forward to other things, not other churches, but just never appreciating the moment that you have. I guess the best way that I can illustrate it for you is that God gave you two eyes, didn't he? Okay, now let me ask you to do something. Let's see if you can do this. I want you to focus on Calvary's Lamb and Messenger of the Covenant over here. See it? Over here? I want you to focus on those two. You got this banner over here, Messenger of the Covenant and Calvary's Lamb. I want you to focus on both of them because you have two eyes at the same time. How's that working for you? You can't do it, can you? You're trying, but you can't. This is what you find out. You find out that you got one head, and you can't split your head, you can't split your eyes. Your eyes can only focus on one object. And if you try to go back and forth, it's just a blur. Folks, that's what Jesus was saying. Focus on the now. Focus on this moment. Focus on this day. Let your eyes be attuned to where he is moving right now. This is what happens to so many of us. We're driving down life's interstate, and we come to this big fork in the road. And as Yogi Berra once said, when you come to the fork in the road, take it. So you're there at this fork in the road, and you're saying, do I go right or do I go left? Kind of like the Zoe in the road, Dr. Seuss. The Zoe in the road, you remember how it said the Zoe couldn't decide whether he wanted to go right or wanted to go left. And so he decided to go both places at the same time. That's how the Zoe in the road had the split in his pants. Now, what happens, though, is you and I can sit there and we can try to decide, do I go here or there? Here or there? And then before you know it, you say, well, I need to shut the car off because I'm burning up gas because I can't decide. So you turn the car off and you sit there and you sit there and you fuss and you cuss and you can't make your mind up. And that's what Jesus was talking about. He said, don't get distracted about living. Let today's worry be enough. He goes on further and offers us four suggestions, and they're very easy. Four suggestions that begin with this. Number one, he says, use your head. Use your head. He says, think, behold, consider. If we used our heads more, we'd understand some things in life are more important than other things in life. That's if we thought. If we really used our heads, we would understand that there are some things in life that are more important than others. Every child knows that a quarter is more valuable than a penny, regardless of how shiny that penny is. That quarter is worth more. To be alive is more important than eating steak at every meal. There are some things that are more important. It is more important to have a healthy body than it is to have designer clothes. We have to use our head. And Jesus says, get your values in order. Get your priorities straight. Worry does not help. By worry, you can't grow one inch taller. By worry, you can't grow any more hair. You can lose some, but you won't grow any. Worry does nothing but injure yourself and affect your walk with God. And I've said this before, and I've had people come and say, really? And I say, yes. Excess worry is a form of atheism. It is the thought that there is not a God who is in control. Two of the most frequent causes of people to go to the emergency room at the hospital, you know what they are? stomach ulcers, and heart problems. Anxiety. Use your head. Number two, remember your Father and trust Him. If God gave us this life, don't you think that He's going to take care of us in this life? I believe that. I don't understand everything. You know, we share probably more with you about our lives than possibly what we should. We don't share that so that you can say, oh, poor, poor, pitiful them. But we share with you because, number one, we want you to pray for us. You can't pray for me as your pastor if you don't know what burdens sometimes I'm dealing with. Now, some burdens I deal with, I have to walk through those things in silence, and I have to walk through those things in isolation, and I have to walk through those things without you knowing it. But some are public. And you know, I have to trust God that He's going to meet my needs. Now, we sometimes have what we call meltdowns at my house. Y'all ever have those? Yeah. We start singing Linda Ronstadt's Poor, Poor, Pitiful Me. And we wonder what we're doing wrong. And, you know, it's just like today we're riding to go have lunch, and we start talking about what my wife refers to as the thorn in our side, this house for 4 years. Still own it. And it is upsetting. What is God trying to teach me? What is God trying to show me? Where am I not being obedient, or is it just, you know, the circumstances in which we find ourselves in? I don't know, but I do know this. God's been faithful. And missed a meal. He's going to prune some things out of my life. And I find it very interesting after you have that talk. About 4 o'clock this afternoon, my phone, I get a text. Somebody might be interested in buying your house. Now, they need to know how old the roof is, and they need to know how old the air conditioner is, and they got to sell their house. Now, I know there's a lot of things there. But sometimes when we verbalize frustrations and we're honest with our feelings, and what seems to be a conversation between two adults is sometimes a prayer to God. Okay, God, what are you trying to show us? And God sends a text about 4 hours later and says, I'm trying to show you I'm still God. I'm trying to show you. Now, nothing may come of it. Who knows? I don't know. But if you search Scripture and you look at Israel in their pilgrimage from Egypt to the Promised Land, God made good on all of His promises. When did things get screwed up? Huh? When they questioned God or turned their backs from Him or just forgot Him completely. Isn't that when things went awry? And what's true of a nation is true of individuals. And this is what can take place. Even the most spiritual people can rock along in spiritual stagnance. You stay where you are. You're going to church. You're doing all the right things. But you're not growing. And so before you know it, you become a sermon taster and a church critic. Because you're not growing in your walk with God. And then you start questioning God. And then before you know it, you're in church still turning your back on God. If an earthly father gave you a car, more than likely he's going to make sure that you have gas to run in that car. Likewise, God doesn't create you and then doesn't supply for your needs. But it doesn't say that He supplies your wants. Right? Paul, from a jail cell, wrote to the church in Philippi, "My God shall supply all of your needs." He didn't say a few. He didn't say a couple. He didn't say 100. He said all of them. God's going to supply all your needs. Remember your Heavenly Father and trust Him. Third, Jesus said, commit yourself to a worthy goal. Commit yourself to something that really matters. You see, we've gotten things out of kilter, and we've gotten things out of balance. This is what Jesus said. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. But we're assuming that all these things are to be added to us before we seek the kingdom of God. See, that's where we've gotten things out of kilter. We had an expression at our last church. It was a theme, if you will. It's called, first things first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. First things first. And all these things will be added unto you. Just as an individual who tries to focus on two objects cannot see, so does one that does not seek the kingdom of God first. It goes a long way to cure worry when you seek the kingdom first. You know what I have noticed? In the last 2 years, before I go to bed, I read God's Word, and I've noticed that I sleep better. I sleep better when I read God's Word. It has a calming effect on me. And it also gives me the understanding that I'm not the only imbecile that's ever walked the face of the earth. That there are imbeciles that were before me, that were as stubborn as I am, that did the same thing that I'm doing. And studying God's Word and seeking His kingdom first goes a long way of letting me know that God is in control. All these things will be added unto you. How do we seek His kingdom? By first inviting Jesus to be a part of your life. Too often, we check our Christianity at the door when we leave on Sunday night. We put on our righteous clothing, we come to church and act spiritual. Then when we leave, we just check our faith at the door. And then we live the way we want to the rest of the week. Do you remember the story in the third chapter of the book of John? Jesus meets with the religious leader. And I think the Bible says something like this. There was a man of the Pharisees by the name of Nicodemus who met with Jesus at night. And Nicodemus said to Jesus, "Good teacher, we know that you are from heaven, for nobody can do the things that you are doing unless God is with them." And Jesus said, "Nicodemus, you must be born again." And Nicodemus said, "How can a man be born again? Can I enter into my mother's womb a second time?" And Jesus said, "That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. You must not marvel, you must not question, that you must be born again." "The wind blows where it wishes, Nicodemus. You don't see where it's coming from, you don't know where it's going, but that's the way it is with the Spirit of God." And folks, let me tell you, the way that you begin this pilgrimage is to take Jesus with you. It is a daily surrender. A few moments ago, we sang "Just a Closer Walk with Thee," which kind of took me back to my old high school days. Have y'all ever heard the song "Just a Bowl of Butter Beans"? Y'all ever heard of that? You can sing "Just a Bowl of Butter Beans" to "Just a Closer Walk with Thee." "Just a bowl of butter beans, pass the cornbread if you please. I don't want no collard greens, just a bowl of butter beans." You can sing it to "Just a Closer Walk with Thee." Have you ever heard that, Wiley? We may sing that at the end of the night. But that song says, how do we walk with Him? Say it. Daily walking close to Thee. Enoch walked with God and was not, for God took him home. To walk with someone is not to walk ahead of someone. To walk with someone is not to lag behind them. To walk with God is like watching an old married couple walking on the beach together, hand in hand, side by side. That's how you walk with God. Find God's will and do it. Folks, let me tell you something. It is sheer misery to be out of the will of God. When you're not in the will of God, you're going to be miserable. Can't help but be miserable. But I can also tell you this. Being in the center of God's will is a scary place. It's a comforting place, but it's a scary place. Do you know why it's scary? You've never been where He's about to take you before in your life. And so there is a little bit of anxiousness. But let me tell you something. I'd rather ride a roller coaster than a merry-go-round any day. Merry-go-round just does this. Oh, you may go up and down a little pony every now and then. But the roller coaster, that's life. Sometimes it's slow. Tick, 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 tick. Sometimes it's fast. Whew. Let me tell you something. We rode the Aerosmith ride at Disney World. My daughter had never ridden a roller coaster in her life. And she's about 17 or 18 years old. And you know, Aerosmith goes from 0 to 60 in like, what, a half a second? Just, and you're gone. It shook her up so much that she had to lay on a park bench for the better part of 3 hours with her head in her mother's lap. That's how much it should. And boy, that thing going all over the place, it scared her to death. But you know, later on she said, it made me sick, but I'm glad I rode it. You know what? Life makes you sick sometimes. You lose somebody special to you, you get this aching feeling in your heart. But then you go back and you see the impact that that person made in your life. There's a warmthness and a comfort, even through the tears. So, you got to ask yourself this question. Where does God want you to serve? Okay, can I kind of clarify something for you? Everybody has to serve. And everybody's going to serve somebody. This is not a spectator sport. God expects you to be involved, whether it's in vacation Bible school or in the choir, Sunday school, making a call. You get involved. Which leads me to my fourth point. That is, get on with the day. Get on with today. Jesus said, let today's problems be enough. What can you do to change yesterday? Anybody? What's the answer? Nothing. And listen to me. Knowledge is a powerful thing. Okay? Knowledge, and what you do with knowledge, is powerful. Let's just say this. Today, you're here at church. Tomorrow, you go to the doctor. Doctor runs a series of tests, comes back to you, and says, we got a problem. There's a malignancy in your body. All right, I'm going to ask you, what's the difference in today and tomorrow? You had that malignancy today. It just didn't sprout in you overnight. The difference is knowledge. You now know. What are you going to do with the knowledge? The same could be true between friends. You find out tomorrow that a friend betrays you. They didn't today, but they may have done it this past week, and you just find it. Now, what are you going to do with the knowledge? Knowledge is powerful, and what you do with the knowledge says a lot about your walk with God. And let me tell you, when we start understanding the past, just think of the past as a string full of helium balloons. And you let them go. Now go get them. Can't do it, can you? So why are you trying to live in yesterday? Mark Twain once said, I had a great future in my past. And we all do. In our past. This church is not what it was. It's not what it's going to be. God has a great future and is making all things new, so we have to get on with you. Have you come here this evening with an anxious heart or with fear of uncertainty? And this is what you need to hear. Your Heavenly Father cares and loves you. Now is the moment for a decision. Let me help you with a simple acrostic, okay? Do you want joy in your life? Do you? That's not a rhetorical question. You want joy? Okay. Let me help you to get it. Just take that word, joy. And here's a simple acrostic. Number one, put Jesus first. You put Him first in your life. Second, the O stands for what? Others. And the Y, yourself. Gail Sayers, prominent running back for the Chicago Bears, was made world famous, really, through a TV special entitled Brian's Song. It was a show about another running back by the name of Brian Piccolo. It was based off of Gail Sayers' book entitled I'm Third. Have y'all seen these bracelets? Does anybody have one of those bracelets on that says, I'm second? Good. Because I don't agree with I'm second. I agree with I'm third. Gail Sayers said, I'm third. And this is what his premise was. My God is first. My friends are second. And I'm third. God's first. My friend and family are second. I'm third. If we live that premise, then God would take the stress and make it manageable. Father, we thank you tonight for loving us so much that you provided us a way to come to you through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that our anxiety, our stress, our disbelief, our bewilderment would somehow be placed at your altar, that you would take it and alleviate it from our lives or help us to control it. We can't add 1 minute to our lives by worry, and stress is only something that will paralyze us in the present. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.